Trump supporters, and they know where we're at. All right? So you've got to really make some noise with me today. How about this great, blessed day in free America? We have been blessed with a president who believes in honoring God first and putting America first. And what more is there to celebrate than that? I'm just very grateful today, and I'm grateful on behalf of NCGOP, the Terry Moore for putting this together, Voter Integrity, our many sponsors, and for Charles Helwig, who could not be our MC today, who's running for the Wake GOP chair, has asked me to be your MC today. My name is Kim Coley, and on behalf of all of us, we say thank you for your support.
Woo! Yeah.
Without further ado, woo! I would like to start off by needing I need a little help. I'm looking for, can you help me, please?
Who?
Come help. This is the way we do it. We raise up the next generation of leaders. Get on up here.
Help of what?
What's your name? Tyler. Hey, Tyler. This is Tyler. Tyler, can you help me ask these people to stand up and let's say the Pledge of Allegiance? Okay. Would you all stand with me, please?
Stand up.
All right, ready? Go ahead. Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America. And to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Woo! Let's get it! Can you come up here and pray the prayer for us, please, sir?
Good morning.
Good morning.
Let's pray down the fire. How about that? That was kind of weak. But anyway, we're going to pray it down anyway. Amen. Yes, sir.
Trains loud.
Just a word.
Leaving the station.
Before we pray, I'm still singing the same song that I sang the last time when we did this on the 4th of March, and it's this: change, lasting change, only comes when our hearts are yielded to Him, to the Lord. Okay? Bottom line, we can't look at a Republican or a Democrat and say it's their fault or they need it, which they all do, but the point of it is this: the only way that there's going to be any change in this nation is to come back to Him. This country was founded upon godly principles, okay?
Cool.
And because of that, and see, we've gotten away from it because, let's face it,
another train.
People have gotten comfortable over the years, over the decades, over the centuries, and then we look and we see, and here we come today. And who would have ever thought that we would be witnessing the things that we witness, hearing the things that we hear? I know back in the mid-70s, I was working in radio, and I had just become a Christian, and I remember going into this Christian bookstore. And I would talk to the guy who owned it, and I was always attracted to Chick Tracks. I don't know if anybody knows what I'm talking about.
No.
With Chick Tracks. I see a head bobbing over there, and I always enjoyed reading them. Now there was one that they had in there, and they were showing about, and he was talking about there would come a time when people would be beheaded.
Oh.
Now I got to be honest with you. I was 23 years old then. And I thought, that ain't going to happen in my lifetime.
Right.
Yes, it does. And that's not just something that happens in the Middle East, okay? If there's anything ever, anything ever been demonic, it's that religion, okay? It's an unclean spirit.
Mm-hmm.
Because of the things that they do.
Yeah.
There's no question about it.
Satanic.
There's no more God in that than the man in the moon.
Right.
Okay? But I want to say this. Here's the good news. Two verses of scripture, then we'll pray.
Mm-hmm.
This is one of my favorites. 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 17 says this: Now the Lord is the Spirit, And where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. Okay? And we look and we go, okay. And let's face it, everybody here wants freedom. I saw some of somebody with the patch on, and it says something about rules, not liking rules. And you know what? If we listen to him, we would be led by his Spirit. And then nobody would have to direct us or say, you can't go here. You can't go there. We wouldn't need the cops out here. But that's not the way it is. And you say, well, how do you get that? You know, the Spirit is not a matter of being something that's disembodied. But Jesus gives us the answer in the Gospel of John, chapter 6, verse 63. And this is what he said. He said, my words are spirit. My words are spirit, and they are life. Okay? So you know something? You don't have to be a rocket scientist to figure it out. But then if the Spirit of the Lord is where there's liberty and freedom, and then he says, my words are spirit, then you know what? You put them together, and that's where we find freedom. Freedom from any bondage, freedom from anything that oppresses. And you know what? Because he created us in his image. And I want to say, it's here for anybody. Lord, even those who cut people's heads off, ooh, he loves them still. Okay? Now, let's pray. Take the hand of the person beside you. They're not going to bite you. If they do, they won't last long.
All by myself.
But Father, as we come to you today, we give you all of the glory and the honor. Father, we thank you that we have been created in your image. Lord, you created us to be able to hear you. You created us to be able to respond to you. And Father, as we've gathered out here today, we thank you and we pray for our nation. Father, in the name of Jesus, I ask that again that you forgive us, this nation, Lord, for the blood that is on our hands. Father, in the name of Jesus, we ask right now, Lord, for your healing in this country. We pray that there will be a boldness, that there will be a yieldedness, Lord, in our elected officials to respond to you with yes. Father, in the name of Jesus, anybody who sees you and knows you knows that there's freedom, there's peace, there's joy. And your scripture says that in the presence of the Lord is fullness of joy. Father, in Jesus' name, we pray right now that, Lord, that you would speak to our hearts now. Lord, that when we will hear what your Spirit is saying, that, Father, that when we leave, that there will be a change in us, Lord, that we would begin to pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, those who oppose this, they're not our enemies. Father, it's a spirit. It's the spirit of this world. Father, your word tells us where there's confusion, there is every evil thing. And Father, we just ask right now for your touch, your freedom, your deliverance, and we break the powers of darkness over our own state government. Father, over our federal government. Father, give President Trump wisdom. Father, give him discernment. Father, I pray that he not be led astray or deceived by somebody who comes as a wolf in sheep's clothing. And Father, we just commit ourselves in this time to you, to your glory, in Jesus' name. And everybody who agrees said, amen.
Amen.
God bless you.
Yeah, my phone fell.
My name is Briley Hussey. If you guys will stand, remove your caps and place your right hand over your heart for the national anthem.
Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight, o'er the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming, and the rockets regular, the bombs bursting in air, get proof through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say does that star-spangled banner yet wave o'er the land of the free and the
Encore! Encore! Woo! Encore! Bravo!
Well, I personally am a Pollyanna. And for those of you that don't know what Pollyanna means, it means I always see the glass half full. I look at the world through rose-colored glasses. But even lately, this Pollyanna can get a little discouraged, overwhelmed by all the negativity that we're constantly being impounded by. You being here today is how you get your backbone, how you remember we're making history, where you realize what we're fighting for, what we fought for, how we've won so far. You guys, this is our opportunity to encourage one another. So before you take a seat, if you haven't done so already, love on somebody next to you as I introduce our first speaker, who is a former Highway Patrol officer and Wake County Sheriff's Officer. Would you please welcome with me your first Go Team Go cheerleader for today, Mr. Jim Stevens.
Thank you very much for asking me to speak today. I wonder if there's anyone here that can recall what occurred on July the 23rd, 2009.
2009.
That was the day that a CNN reporter reported that President Obama said that the police in Cambridge, Massachusetts, quote, acted stupidly in arresting a prominent black Harvard professor after a confrontation at the man's home. That was all the details President Obama had at that time. A prominent black professor had been arrested in a confrontation at his home. Yet, that alone was enough information for the President of the United States to declare publicly the police acted stupidly. President Trump, he's often criticized for speaking out unconventionally and sometimes not being as politically correct as some would prefer.
Yeah.
But I don't believe he has or would without having the pertinent facts criticize a dedicated, brave, and professional peace officer who was, in fact, performing his sworn duties. I retired in 2015 after 44 years of serving my community, my county, and my state as a law enforcement officer. I served my country in the United States Armed Forces. I have served my church as a Sunday school teacher and a deacon. I have contributed to worthy charities. I've paid my bills and my taxes on time. I've never been arrested, never used illegal drugs, and I raised and educated my daughter. I maintained my faith in the Lord Jesus Christ even while my wife was suffering and dying with brain cancer. I continued to rely on him a year later when I was diagnosed with stage 4 cancer. I fought. I prayed. And I was surrounded with a lot of great people. and I survived. But in the eyes of at least one presidential candidate, I am deplorable. Well, you know, there's a lot of deplorable people, men and women out there right now, with stories similar to mine and similar to yours. Servants of the people who are risking their lives every single day to keep us safe. There are hundreds of thousands of first responders in this country who are doing difficult and dangerous work. And they're not only serving and protecting their fellow citizens, they are literally holding together the fabric that makes America the great nation that it is. Imagine if you can one day without law enforcement.
Oh, no.
Education, is as important as it is, would be impossible. The legislature could not function were it not for officers to enforce the laws they make. Men, women, and children would not be safe in their own homes, at school, at work, or on the streets. Now, of course, not every single individual officer is of noble character, but by far, the vast majority are dedicated, devoted, and courageous men and women. Mm-hmm. But they need help,
yeah.
And especially support.
I'm willing to help.
Support from the citizens that they serve and support from our governmental leaders. They do not need leaders who criticize them for doing their jobs properly.
Exactly.
They do not deserve to be called racist,
no.
homophobes, mm-mm. xenophobes when they enforce the law without regard for social status,
right.
just as they should.
Right.
Rather, they deserve to be appreciated. They deserve to have judges and justices right up to the Supreme Court appointed who are willing to give the police the tools they need within the intended limits of the Constitution.
Right.
We now have a president willing to do those very things. Let us support him and support our law enforcement officers.
Woo! Woo!
Great day. Thank you so much, Mr. Stevens. I am looking and I don't see him yet, so I'm going to continue on. Mark Brody, come on up. I'm sorry, I know I threw you off, sir, and I apologize for that. Ladies and gentlemen, this is Mark Brody. He is a member of the North Carolina House of Representatives from District 55, representing Union and Anson counties. He is also the Republican National
Committee. There's a county called Union.
From North Carolina, representing the North Carolina Republican Party. He has been married for 41 years.
Wow.
Where's your wife? I want
43.
We've got a typo.
43 years.
That's 43 it. Years to his wife, Lisa, and has three daughters and three grandchildren. Three. Are we still three? Okay.
Okay.
Today, like many of you, Mark made a long trip to come speak with us, driving 3 hours to come show us his support for President Trump.
Cool.
Would you please welcome with me Mr. Mark Brody?
Woo!
Thank you very much. I wanted to just start out by introduce myself. I'm a state representative. I'm also a member of the House or the Legislative Freedom Caucus. And yes, we do have a Freedom Caucus in our legislature. But I wanted to... thanks. I wanted to say that you probably don't hear a lot of noise from me because I'm a conservative, but I tend to do things that on a quiet basis. Although occasionally I do get in the news. I don't know if you've heard of the bill out there that's about to challenge the NCAA and the ACC for their tax exempt status. Well, that's my bill. And I think we've just had enough of this foolishness and we need to get down to it. I've also had the ability to meet up with the transgender folks, and I guess it was quoted as saying that transgenderism, political transgenderism, is not something you're born with. It's a choice.
Yeah.
And you decide to do that, and basing on the comment that I got from scientific evidence, you plain have a mental disorder.
Yeah.
And I publicly said that, and when asked, do I want to retract it, I said absolutely not.
No.
I will not do that.
You have a right to say so.
And also, I've spent some time writing down a couple of notes, and so forgive me for somewhat reading this. I just wasn't ever born a natural speaker, so I'm going to have to rely. But here it goes. Fellow Republicans, independents, and even Democrats were just curious about seeking information. I come from Union County to stand with you in celebrating the victory, the dedication to his promises, and the ultimate success of our President Donald Trump.
Uh-huh.
Many of you here know me, but some don't. So, like I said, I'm a representative for Union County and also a member of the vice chair of the Freedom Caucus and a member of the RNC. And the reason I ran for the position of RNC is because I felt it was important that I bring
North Carolina
traditional values to Washington. And sometimes they go a little liberal and they need some correcting now and then.
Yeah.
So I think I would do my part in that.
Right.
I want to speak to you about the successes of North Carolina and the vast potential of this state as President Trump moves forward with his agenda that he laid out during the campaign and began from day one to implement. North Carolina is a sovereign state, meaning it's subject itself to this great nation, passing on only limited authority to the federal government while keeping the rest for itself. The last 8 years have seen an unprecedented assault on our liberties, forced changes in our traditional values and cultural norms, a radical reinterpretation of our Constitution, and the Democrats, who have been appointed to lifelong positions in our judiciary, have taken to political activism as a legislative option. Even with facing those issues, North Carolina has been recognized as having the fastest rate of economic growth in the nation in the past 3 years. Tourism, believe it or not, is at a record high in North Carolina, tripling the national average of the nation itself.
Wowzers.
And 400 new private sector jobs have been created since the legislature became Republican. North Carolina is doing well, and the Trump era has just begun. Donald Trump believes in the 50 states being 50 laboratories of innovation, and so do I. For an example, our state has sent a Medicaid reform package to the Obama administration 3 years ago, which we estimated would save ourselves another $500 million while still giving better service and providing for more people. But we got no response. If President Trump block grants this money, as he stated, we'll be able to move forward with those reforms and add another $500 million to the surplus we already have. Those of you who don't know, we have a $500 million surplus.
Wowzers.
Yeah, thank you.
Under the McCrory administration, yes.
The McCrory administration.
President Trump directs Congress and our new Secretary of Education to block grant our education funding, we will be able to implement long overdue changes in our education system, including finally ridding ourselves of the disaster known as Common Core.
Oh, yeah.
North Carolina, being the most military-friendly state in the Union, stands ready to help in a readiness buildup, improving our preparedness of our men and women for training and the tasks that they have to do, and the ultimate care and support of our veterans when their service ends. Nominee Trump spent a lot of time in North Carolina, so we got to know him better than most in the nation. We got to know his personal beliefs, God, family, country, and a work ethic that we can be proud to use as a role model for our children.
Right.
He's a principled leader, and he believes that the Constitution of our nation is, as we call in our Republican platform, an enduring covenant between the people of this nation and a government that is meant to be subservient. In light of that, he has sought out judges to serve on our Supreme Court who believe in that idea also. And we are now in the process, as you know, of confirming our first. It's our hope that the courts can soon get back to their prime function of serving as impartial arbiters and not lawmakers. As long as I'm on the subject of values, President Trump has made it clear he does not support the Obama administration's obsession with gender identity, and he's reversed his executive order dealing with that subject.
If you're born a male, you're a male. If you're born a female,
moreover, as a matter of record here, and so everybody knows, I voted originally for HB2. I have no intention of ever repealing it, and I stand ready to put an end to this economic extortion that the Democrats and the governors are keeping on our state. As a Republican legislator who can say that myself and my colleagues have accomplished a lot, I look forward to the Trump era as it unfolds. A reduction in job-killing regulations, especially from the EPA, can streamline business growth in North Carolina. A repeal of Dodd-Frank and free up capital for business expansion, and negotiating better trade deals can increase demand for American products and markets to the world. As I wind down, I want to say, as we enter the Trump era, we Republicans, independents, and even Democrats who haven't yet realized that the Democrat Party has long since left them behind, we affirm the principles that unite us in a common cause and purpose. We wish for peace, so we insist on strength. We seek friendship with all peoples, but remain to prepare to deal with evil. We demand control of our borders while we reject government control over our schools, farms, businesses, and religious institutions. We insist on enforcement of our laws, recognizing that only elected officials can make those laws. We believe in our constitutional system, limited government, separation of powers, federalism, and the rights of the people. And we believe that America is an exceptional nation, and thank God we have a president who does so also.
Right.
Thank you very much.
Woo!
Make America great again.